Right, let's try again.
Okay.
First one she is. Cheers. I'll see you. And yeah.
Alcoholic
beers. Yeah, I'll see you. Well, I've done things that I'm proud of and things that I ain't. It all goes to ground in the end.
I am Matt Wise. I am the music handy man. I do touring work, drums and guitars, backline tech, tour management, production management, stage management, that sort of thing. It's quite like mid-level bands.
Yeah, yeah.
It's basically driving.
Yeah.
And yeah, just like looking after finance and making sure people are where they need to be. I quite enjoy it because you're kind of like mother hen a little bit.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
When you're prepared for any sort of scenario, then it's quite satisfying. And then at home, I have a guitar repair and restoration workshop, and it's all freelance basically. I went to Access to Music in Lincoln.
Nice.
In whatever order of words it was, contemporary performance music something, and then there was more of a business side with it, and a little bit of using Logic, so like the more production side of it, and I got just super hooked on just playing drums in whatever format. Recording was really fun because it's like a different sort of style of playing, you know. You can do it in bits,
yeah,
and you can be really meticulous about how things are tuned and how things are set up and microphone placement and stuff like that. You just learn a lot, and it's so different from like a live performance. I did have a band before that when I was still in school. It was bad. Of course it was. And then yeah, Access at the time, I don't know what they do now, but they sort of force everyone into a band together.
Okay.
Which is quite, it's like kind of nerve-wracking because you've just left school and everything's strict and like boring. And then all of a sudden, like, now you're in a band. Yes!
Yeah.
That's exciting! Put in a room, five of you, and just do something.
So encouraged to play what you want to play.
Exactly. Yeah. Whatever you want to play. And it was like encouraged.
Good.
Yeah. And then they basically just booked some gigs for us. And that was like our taste of it to begin with. And it was very liberating to finally feel like we're kind of making some music and playing it to people.
Yeah, yeah.
I was putting a show on. I was going to play. Asked Crazy Arm if they wanted to play. And they said yes. It was going to be Kind.
Oh, wow, okay. Yeah.
And then Darren texted me and said, our drummer's not in the band anymore.
Right, so okay.
I know your songs. Drums. And then went to Playing Loud, set up my drums, bunch of microphones, and like filmed me playing all of their songs.
Okay.
And sent it to Darren and was like, do you want to come for practice? I was like, yes.
For them, they needed a drummer. And then you've just gone, here's it on a silver plate.
Yeah.
Like, it's me literally playing your songs.
Yeah. And then moved to Plymouth.
Yeah.
Nice. And since then as well, it's kind of been quite a good gateway to meet people. And that's kind of how my touring stuff has kind of started out.
Oh, okay.
Through Crazy Arm.
Yeah, yeah.
On the road or friends or whoever else.
When you meet these people, though, do you think it's your experiences and skill set that helps? Do you think it's the more of a personal thing, like when you meet these people? Because we talk about networking a lot, and actually, what does that mean?
I think being honest about what you can do, what you're capable of,
yeah,
without just like bragging, you know. There's quite a fine line between it, and I think plenty of people probably find it difficult trying to keep below the brag thing, so they just end up not saying anything about themselves for fear of sounding like but I think just being honest about it and just saying what you're up to and what you've done, you know, it's just factual, isn't it? And I think if you show how passionate you are about music or the arts or like any part of that, of the industry, then it just really resonates with someone, because like the person that you're talking to probably has a very similar level of passion for it.
Yeah.
So that you can just see it. I can see it with you. I can see it with like Scott and a bunch of friends around here, you know, like it shows and it's nice, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And I want to be around those people. And that's just, I feel like that's kind of what, how networking has worked for me.
Can we talk about your touring work? Just generally, what have you been doing past few years? Again, I've not seen you for years.
Sure.
What's been going on?
So, I was playing jobs for Humour Project for a while.
Okay.
So that's sort of after Crazy Arm. Did that. It was like 3 years of it. And then their old drummer came back. And it was great. Did Japan and Canada, a bunch of Europe and UK stuff. Nice bunch of people.
Mm.
Kind of a scene that I've not really been around too much, like the skate punk stuff.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Most of my bands have been like hardcore and like ratty punk. And then to have this more polished, it's like a totally different set of people that go to those shows.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's, and they're all very pleasant people. It's a nice scene. And then there was lockdown. And then 2021, I feel like it was, Crazy Arm did a few shows with the Skints.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And their guitar tech was a guy called Ben Robinson, who is the production manager for Sum 41 as well. And he knows the Skints, they're all friends, been friends for years, and he just, when he's free, he does it for free, just like as a, because he likes hanging out. And it's quite an easy job. You know? So it's, yeah, that was quite nice, and I just started talking to him.
Yeah.
And said, you know, I've got this workshop at home that I've sort of started building, but I love touring, so if there's a way that I can do both,
yeah,
that you know of, I mean, like, he's the guitar tech, and I'm like, I want to do a bit of that. That looks, that looks good. I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was kind of, yeah, I'll let you know. If anything comes up, I'll give you a shout. And it's like, you know, when you're kind of drunk and you're creating bands with friends that never turn into anything. It's just like, oh, we should totally do this crazy band. And then nothing ever turns up. I kind of thought, just put it to bed. Just carried on doing what I was doing. I was quite happy anyway. And then he called me up and he said, are you free? For a couple of months, 2022. And that was a band called The Who, the H-U.
Oh, right, yeah.
Not
yeah.
the English band. Yeah. Yeah, so that's an eight-piece Mongolian sort of rock metal band.
Okay, that's cool. We'll have to check them out.
Like traditional Mongolian instruments, a couple of guitars and a bass and stuff like that. Two drum kits.
Nice, nice. That must be fun to set up on
stage. Yeah, so that was meant to be, I was just meant to guitar tech for that and babysit monitors.
Okay.
And I was like, yeah, I can do that. Cool. Turned up, I'm the only tech. There's a front of house, and there's a LD, but there was no drum tech or monitors or anything. So I was doing, I was setting up both drum kits, doing all the guitars, doing the morinkers and the tobshers, and stage managing the whole thing, and like, when they were playing, just like on an iPad, just messing about with their monitor levels and their ears, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it was so much work. But it was good. And that sort of turned into more stuff because it was, I felt like I was quite, you know, after a first few shows of it, just felt quite capable.
Mm.
I was like, all right, yeah, I can do this. It's a lot, but, you know, I've been delivering beers for like 10 years.
Yeah.
Like that's quite tough. So this is also tough and I like it. Walking disaster. But you know, there are other bands. So that that moved on to, I did Sum 41 after that. So yeah, Ben was like, actually I need a guitar to help with backline basically.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cause he also does so much for them as well. Like he, sort of part tour manager with advancing all of the production stuff to the venues and then gets there, he looks after guitars and like stage manager, just doing a lot of stuff. There is a drum tech and a monitors guy and all that, but he also does a lot and he just needed a hand and that was great for me.
Yeah.
And then yeah, they just kept asking me back. Quite a nice.
Why were they asking you back, do you think? Modesty aside.
Modesty aside. Dave Brown Sound said his guitar has never played so good.
There we go.
So that was very encouraging.
Yeah.
That was a very nice thing to hear.
Yeah.
From someone that was like, I used to watch you coming out of a swimming pool playing a guitar solo for years. Yeah, cool. All right. And yeah, just got on with them. Quite well. You know, just.
It's a huge part of it, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. But are there any challenges? Like, we're touring, general, like, tour work. What are the challenges? What are the things that change?
Yeah, sleeping.
Yeah.
Lack thereof. Contracts. Yeah, okay, let's talk about contracts.
Okay, okay.
They don't really exist.
Right.
That's definitely a challenge. You can't... It's weird to ask for some sort of guarantee. Like... Generally, if they say this is how much you'll get paid every day, that's how it works. You know,
okay.
You will get paid, and
yeah.
It will usually be on time. And, and so this year, I've had two tours cancel last minute.
Right.
There was one in January that cancelled the week before, and then there was a Sum 41 tour that cancelled 2 days before, and then all of a sudden you've got this just big space in your calendar with no work. You know, because you've planned for it.
Yeah.
And there's not like, sometimes there's a cancellation fee, you know, if they take pity. Not, you know, like, it was kind of annoying, but that's how it is sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not going to stop doing it. You know, I'll keep trying.
Cause yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because when it works, it works. But yeah, there's always that fear of, you know, this might not work. It's quite fragile, and it can be a bit nerve-wracking, and that takes quite a lot of mental space to just try and ignore it a little bit, you know.
Yeah.
That's the only way to really go about it. That's what I do anyway. Maybe it's not a good idea.
What, you know, in the current like cultural sector, you're like, if I'm going to sort of embody the whole sector, what do you think are the current challenges, like things that are really making this difficult?
Brexit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Brexit and funding. So yeah, like grassroots venues are just the, you know, the backbone of the music industry.
Mm.
Without them, everything else falls apart. You can't put a local band for 50 quid in an O2 because no one's going to be there, and it's not, nobody's going to get any money out of it, and you know, it's just, it doesn't work. So you need small venues to work, and there's just no funding for it. Like, there was Music Venue Trust, just like an independent body, raised 2 million quid in March.
It's incredible.
For, yeah, if it, like, it's 2 million quid important that someone communally, people have decided that that's worth investing in.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't think of a clearer point to make than that. I mean, this is where money needs to be going. Arts, the whole arts industry and music and everything is just important. People like entertainment as well, you know? And it brings money, you know, touring bands, international or local or whatever, bring money to cities, you know? You fill a venue out, and that's work, and it's excitement, and people will travel from another neighbouring city and come in, and it's like small-scale tourism.
We've got some guest speakers today.
Yeah, there you go. He's right, you know.
Talked about challenges before. Why do you do it? What are the positive aspects of work?
Positive aspects? Quite obvious ones. The people.
Yeah.
Is a good place to start. You meet all kinds of people. Some of them are nice, some of them are not very nice, but it's all kind of worth it. It's all very character building, you know, and especially as a musician, talking to musicians who have had a successful career of it, it's quite interesting to see it, but you know, they're just people. They're just like anyone else. And a lot of the time they do know it. They know that they're, for lack of a better word, not special. You know, I mean, like, they're great musicians. You know, they are, like you say, like, they're skilled people. And they have committed to a career that's very admirable, and they make music that I enjoy, someone enjoys. So, you know, that, like, that's, that makes them special. But they, you know, when they're not playing music, they're just people.
Yeah, yeah.
And they'll hang, they like to hang out, and they like to go for a beer, and they like to exercise, and, you know, people stuff. The culture differences is always very enjoyable, you know, like going to Japan and seeing, it gives you an opportunity, like, when, like, I can't afford to go to Japan on a holiday, you know, for, yeah, for 2 weeks, like, yeah, that's a whole thing, but, like, to be sort of, to be paid to the point where it breaks even, to be there is, like, an insight, and especially into, like, a punk scene, you know, like, something that I give a lot of shit about in at home, to go to like a completely different world,
yeah, yeah,
and experience that is very special.
So when you've been working with like Sum 41, so when you're not performing, anything, any highlights or any like, or achievements, anything that you've been like, actually nailed that, or that was just a great night or a great day?
On the Who tour, not the English band.
I'll put like a subtitle,
yeah, every, yeah,
time. Not the Who.
Not the Who. It was basically two buses with trailers, and all the gear was in the trailers. And the bus that had all of the backline in it got stuck in traffic and was like 2 hours late. So load in. We did it in like 40 minutes. Like everything was set up. Taken off the trailer, brought into the thing, out of cases, set up, mic'd up. It was coming out of front house after 40 minutes, and it was like,
wow.
Yes!
Yeah, yeah.
Pulled it out the back. Like, everybody just, like, shut up and worked together, and it was great. So little highlights like that can be very satisfying.
Mm.
And quite like, well, you know, if anything goes wrong, we know that we can do it, so.
Okay. For anyone who is either new or looking for a career change, like coming into the industry, where do you start?
If you want to get into the teching stuff, the stagehand world,
yeah,
go to a venue and ask if you can have a day. They'll probably pay you. Work your way up into more, you know, more of a specialist. Find out what you like first. You know, like there's space for photographers, videographers, all kinds of audio. If you don't necessarily like doing front house, there's always monitors. Like, it's the same gear, but a different world.
Yeah.
Guitar teching, drum teching, just stage management, or artist liaison, or like massage therapy people that, you know, barbers on,
yeah,
tour.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
like it's the whole world is out there.
It'll look good
because people still need to have a, you know, look presentable,
yeah,
and feel, you know, people get injuries, people get fatigued, every aspect of it needs looking after. So if there's something that you are quite passionate about and you want to talk, then there's bound to be a world that you can fit into. You just need to find the thing that you like. You can get comfortable in a job outside of the music industry. You have all these passions and all these dreams of like doing something that's not the job that you might be doing, and then it's very easy to feel comfortable and not leave that world, and jumping ship almost is scary as hell, because, yeah, yeah, like, oh well, if I quit my job, where am I, how do I pay the bills? It's like, go get it. You gotta fight. It's up to you. It's in the air.
Yeah.
Nobody's gonna help you out. You just gotta try it, I guess.
Just gotta get in there. Yeah. Go for it.
And it'll pay off at some point. I don't want to. Sound like I'm putting people off doing
it. No, it's honesty. It's being, yeah, transparent. Isn't it? It is challenging. So that's it.
Challenging but worth it. Definitely worth it.
Cool. That could be the final phrase. I like that. Challenging but worth it.
So worth it.
Okay. Well, thanks, Matt. Great to see you.
Good to see you too.
Yeah.
Excellent shirt.